Hello YouTubers, and welcome to this video where we're going to talk about the process of kind of interconnecting the Seplos battery packs. So if you've been following my channel, you'll know that Seplos kindly sent me one pack to assemble as a DIY project, and I did that in a previous video. I then received a further three packs for a total of four, just over 20 kilowatt hours for my solar powered carport project. And I've now reached the stage where I've got to stack them all up and link them all up, ready to commission my inverter. Now, I haven't commissioned my inverter yet. The reason I'm doing this video is to try and help folks with this process of actually connecting them up, because there's a fair bit to take into consideration. If I was just to rush you to the pack now and go, do this, do that, flip these dip switches, I wouldn't be doing any better than the manual. And I think having a bigger picture of understanding why you set a certain address settings on the pack for RS485 versus CAN bus, how you set it up so it can be seen by the software, is important, because the manual doesn't give that kind of background. And also, as I've noted in a previous video, there's a silly process where if you want the battery pack to be seen by the inverter, you set the dip switches one way, and then if you want to look at the battery pack with the software, you have to readdress the whole battery pack. Now, the engineers at Seplos, I brought this to their attention, and apparently they're already working on this. They're hoping to improve it, but this is one of the quirks of this battery pack. And as I said, when I started out doing this, and I called my first video CAN bus of worms, and indeed, it's still not that straightforward to do this interfacing with lithium battery packs and a CAN bus and inverter. I believe Seplos and people like GrowWatt have gone a long way to trying to make this better, but there are still some stumbling blocks and challenges. And that's, I say, we are going to go. I'm going to show you my pack and the process of getting it together and the things to watch out for and the little stumbling blocks you can hit. I want to warn you up front, if you are not comfortable with working with batteries, particularly batteries with a lot of energy, it can be very dangerous. It can cause you harm. It can even be fatal. The one thing which can be very easy for someone to make a mistake on, I've made this mistake, is at thinking, it's just a battery. It's not mains electricity that is going to shock me or electrocute you. These batteries are sitting at a nominal 48 or 52 volts. If you hold the two terminals of a battery at that voltage, it definitely has the potential to push a current through you, and that could be very dangerous, or in some cases fatal. So just remember that. If you're not comfortable, get someone else to do this. Now, I will say the nice thing about these types of battery packs and the ones that Seplos are putting together, the interconnects, they don't have any metal terminals exposed or readily exposed that you can touch or have a piece of jewelry or a tool touch to cause a short and an issue. The real only point that you're going to have something that you can touch is when you get the two main battery leads that you connect to your inverter. If the battery is live, then there you got a potential for a huge amount of energy in a short circuit. So just be aware about that. But they've done a great job in that there's nothing else exposed. And when I take you to the pack, I'm going to show you how you can avoid those being live, or what to do to in terms of safety. But if you're unsure, don't do it yourself. Right, so let me go through a little bit of explanation then in terms of how these packs go together, and particularly the addressing. So the one thing to be mindful of is that these battery packs have two protocols. On each battery, there are three RJ45 ports. So the RJ45 is just the physical type connection. It's like you'd have an Ethernet connection, a network cable. But here, they're not talking Ethernet. The two protocols are RS485 and CAN bus. Now, in between the batteries, they communicate, and you link them together with these little cables. They talk RS485. But you can use either CAN bus, in my case with GrowWatt. You can use the CAN bus communication, because the GrowWatt is CAN bus. Or I believe you could obviously use RS485 for inverters that support that. the software. I've got a laptop there with the software which allows you to look at the status of each battery pack and all the individual cells and any warnings or what have you. They communicate via RS-485. Now the complication comes in that the two protocols are different. One's a duplex or bi-directional, and one's a simplex one direction communication. And the addressing on the DIP switches for these at the moment, the way they're designed, needs to change depending on whether you're communicating RS-485 to an inverter or CAN bus. Now in my case, and this is where the complication comes in, is that the GrowWatt is CAN bus, and this is where you have the issue where if you want to talk to the inverter, the DIP switches need to be set up one way, and if you want to use software to talk to the batteries, you have to switch them another way. Understanding how these DIP switches work in terms of that it's a binary addressing system. The first part of the DIP switch, 1 to 4, is giving each pack an address. The second set, or 5 to 8, is basically telling the master pack how many slaves you've got. In the manual, it can be quite confusing because what they do, for one, the first manual I had a typo where it repeated the DIP switch settings 1 to 4, 1 to 4, when it should have been 1 to 4 and 5 to 8. I've now got an updated manual, but in the first part of the manual, they start, when they show you the DIP switch settings, they go 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, whereas the physical DIP switch is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So you're working backwards. They also don't explain this issue with between CAN bus and 485 and having to change the DIP switches to address it. In the manual, at the bottom, they've got an appendix, and that's probably the best thing to look at. And they'll talk about an RS-485 setup and a CAN bus setup. And basically, if you only have one pack, all the DIP switches are left off and you're home and dry. It's that easy. So that is the architecture behind the addressing system on these. And as I said, the catch is that then when you want to go and speak with the software, I'm going to show you a little shortcut that I've discovered. I don't think it really messes up what's going on, but when we get to the battery pack outside, I'll explain that. So let's go there now. Right then, so before we get stuck in, I just want to do a bit of freehand just to show you the setup and just to walk you through a few bits before we actually get to the DIP switches and the configuration of the battery bank. So once you have your battery bank, you would obviously get these stacked up. I was provided with a base, and if you are going to have a number of these battery packs that you're working with, I assume you'll get a base, or it makes sense to have a base because it has wheels, it's built to take the weight of these. These are quite heavy, and obviously having them stacked up, you do want a nice, stable, firm platform. You can see how it flares out at the bottom, which will give it more stability. In this case, I already have these cables connected and the communication wires connected, or the network cables connected. You would be in a situation, presumably, where none of that is connected, and I'm explaining there's a very specific order to do things in terms of getting this communicating correctly, and particularly safety. And I'll explain the safety issue is that when these arrive, they are going to be in a kind of a sleep mode. These have a reset button right over there, which could be used to wake the battery up, and that will also make the terminals live. So the actual terminals that you connect to will then become live, and you don't want them live when you're connecting them up. I had them live, and I certainly saw an instance where there was a spark, and I'll explain why that happened. You can wake all the batteries up by having all these interconnects in place and just pushing the one reset button. You can also put it back to sleep, and I'm going to demonstrate that. But I would leave these communication cables to last so that you're not in a situation where that maybe gets accidentally pushed, or you don't want them all woken up at the same time. I would only install these cables last. I do have my inverters already up on the wall, and that'll be the next step, is to commission those once I've gone through the setup. But that'll be in another video. Right, so during this filming, you're gonna have to excuse, I'm gonna be washed out sometimes. There's some sun coming through here, but not a lot of light here. So I'll play with the contrast and what have you on the camera when it's required. The first thing I want to point out though is that be mindful that there are some really nice securing clips on both sides and the back of these battery packs. And it makes sense to get them nicely clipped in and secured in so that you've got a nice stable pack. This is very heavy. You don't want any situation where this is going to topple because they will be either damaged or someone's going to get hurt. Right, so you've obviously got the main leads which go to the inverter, and then you're going to have these little interconnects which go and connect all of these in parallel. They've got a really nice connection system. You can see I've got these little covers on there, and I kind of keep these on for protection, but the contacts and the connection points are nicely designed that there's no metal exposed. So there's no real easy risk to cause a short unless you actually stick something in there, because the metal contact is right inside. And these little interconnects are designed to pick up that metal contact with a nice piece of interconnecting cable in terms of linking up. Now the one thing be mindful of, though, in this situation there's not a lot exposed, if you have any jewelry, so any necklaces, wristwatches, rings, it might be a good time to take them off, even though in this case I think the risk is small. If anything is dangling and touches or shorts something, it's just best to try and avoid that. Now, when you get these packs, I would say definitely do not push the reset button to wake it up. That is going to be one of your last steps once you've got everything connected up to your inverter. Now, in this case, I don't have it connected up to my inverter yet. And if you're like me, where you want to at least see the pack before you connect to your inverter, you can do that, but then put them back to sleep. Don't connect with a set of live cables, with a battery being awake and a set of live cables. So when you get it, you're going to have these interconnects. You can see some have got the black for the negative side, and then you've got the kind of bright orange for the positive side. You also have these earth connections. So perhaps the first thing I would do is go and connect all these earth connections. So all of the battery packs are earthed. You can then take these off to another earth. And we're going to talk about earthing in a system like this once we start commissioning the system. So connect your earths on here. An important point to note is that the chassis of this and these earth points are not common to the negative, okay, which is important to know, and I'm thankful that certainly in this case they haven't done that. So you connect all your earths and then you connect these. Now the thing to note that on here, and I'll do a closer shot, you've got some tabs so you can only push this connector in one way. Right, and just to demonstrate how these little terminal connectors work, if you look carefully here on this negative one, you can see there's a bigger tab setting over here and then a small little tab setting over here. And if you look at the interconnect, obviously it's going to be different because I'm showing it in the different direction from where you'd actually connect it. You can see those two tabs here, a smaller tab and a bigger tab. And then on the outside, you can see there's a little arrow pointing to the bigger tab. So what you need to do basically is align that arrow with that bigger tab when you want to connect, this. And you can swing this around to get it into the direction that you want. So you'd swing it around. And let's say, for instance, I want to line this up so it's easier for me doing this on camera. That way, you can see the arrow is over there. I've got that facing that way over there. If you heard that clicked in place. And there's a nice little push button over here that releases. So if you hold that down and then pull it off, it comes off nice and easily. So I must say, a very nice system. In my mind, nice and secure. It makes it nice and safe and easy connecting these packs. It can be awkward trying to put these in there, swivel it around, but once you get the knack of it, you'll go in there and it'll make a nice positive click sound once you've connected these. I would do the positive side first, right? And I've explained this in a previous video why if you're connecting things, you always connect positive first and then your negative. And when you're disconnecting, you disconnect your negative first to avoid a ground being there, and then disconnect your positive. So go and connect all of these. You'll see I've done these with the loop facing out. Now if you've got battery packs or something, this is going to be near a wall, this might be a problem. The reason I've done this is so that these loops don't go across the dip switches or any of the LEDs on here. So you can choose to do them inside, or I've seen In fact, in Seplos, in one of their videos, they alternate like an S. You can go inside, outside, or have them all inside. So just be mindful when you connect them up. You've got that choice. Just think about where you're going to place this pack. You connect your positive, so you can see you can leave your two top connections free. Those are for your main power leads. Now in my case, I just want to point out at the bottom of my pack, I've got two free ports, which you'll have as well. I happen to have two sets of power cables, and I've asked, and obviously everything's connected in parallel. Because I'm going to two inverters, I'm actually going to split the load between the top connectors and the bottom. That's not going to be the case for 99% of consumers who get these, because they are only going to get one set of leads. I got two because I got one pack sent as a DIY pack. It came with leads, and then I got another set of leads with the other three. But just be mindful that if you were in that situation, I've been told by Seplos, you can have two sets of leads connected. And that would, of course, split the load going through all these interconnects. So once you've got all your interconnects to connect the packs in parallel, you can then go and use these shorter interconnects, and I'll just pull one out to show you, to go and connect between the batteries using the RS485. And on here you'll see they've got noted RS485-1, presumably meaning the first port, RS485-2. Now, to the best of my knowledge, these are just common, so it doesn't matter whether you just loop straight down or go crosswise. You'll see in their video they tend to go in a cross pattern. I've tried it different ways. When I've got the communication cable to my laptop, which is the longer one, I've gone and stuck it in the middle, and it still communicates. So I believe all the RS485 are common, but you'll go and connect all these battery packs and with these RJ45 connectors, and that allows the communication between the packs. Now it comes to the DIP switch addressing. And here, if you want to first have a look at these with the software, and there are a couple of reasons for that. You may want to see their state of health, what their state of charge is. You can also update the firmware. So that was one of the first things I did. The BMS in here is firmware upgradable. So I went in, I used the software, and I upgraded all of the firmware on here. Now, if you want to address these in a straightforward way, the one thing would be to go, and I say in the appendix I'm going to bring up on the screen, that's the best thing to look at, is to look at the DIP switch configuration for the RS485. It is fairly straightforward. Basically, you're only using the first four DIP switches in a binary addressing system. You'd address the first pack as number 1, 2, 3, 4, in my case with four packs, and you'd obviously continue if you've got more in parallel. When you've got those DIP switches set, 5, 6, 7, 8 are just set down to 0. Then they're not set in this case when you if you're communicating via RS485. That will allow you, you've got a USB dongle that will interface with the cable. I'm going to show you the software. I'm going to talk about you have to, what they call is an agreement. It basically, you pull in a configuration file for the type of battery, the number of cells you got. That also updates the language. So the one thing is, when you download the software, it's going to be in Mandarin or Chinese, and you need to pull that agreement file in. I believe it's a configuration file to allow you to pull in the English and then the configuration for these cells. But by doing that and setting this up for RS485, you'll be able to see all of these straight away in the software. Now, if we go to CAN bus, that is when you need to then address the first pack at the top. Logically, it makes sense to have the one at the top as your master. That first DIP switch is that this first DIP switch setting on the first one will now all go down to 0. It becomes address 0. And then in my case, 5 and 6, 5 being a value of 1 binary, because we're now onto the second part of the addressing, telling it how many packs it's got. 6 is value 2, together that is 3. That is telling it I've got 3 slaves attached. So that is set that way, and then your first slave gets an address of 1, second slave address of 2, third slave address of 3. And that is the construct behind the DIP switch setting. Now, I'll just tell you while I'm sitting here, that in their video and kind of what they expect you to do is, let's say you go and set that up now because you're going to use the CAN bus connection. You've now configured it for CAN bus to speak to your inverter. If you then want to address these via the software, you'll see in the video, they go and change all of the addressing of all of these back to 1, 2, 3, 4, which means changing all the DIP switches so you can address it with the software. The way around that, and I don't see any harm in doing this, as opposed to doing that, is to just change the top one to say an address of 5 or 6 or 7 or 8, because you're not using that address. Depending on the number of packs you've got, you address it one greater than the number of packs you've got. And then just remember that you've got this one which is addressed at an odd number. It doesn't matter, the software will see it. So let's say, for instance, I call this number 8. It'll be 8, 1, 2, 3. And I'll be able to see it like that in the software. I'm going to show you that the terminals are not live as it is now in a standby state. And I'm going to wake it up and then put it back to sleep to show you how you do that. Right then, so what I want to show you, I've gingerly put my test leads in the positive and the negative, and I want to show you there's just a very slight, almost like float voltage of a few millivolts at the terminals at the moment. They're not live. Now we'll see when I activate it whether I've actually made contact or not, but I can assure you that at the moment the main FET, power FET or what have you, that switches these terminals live is switched off. So the one big reason for leaving these switched off while you're connecting up is that the batteries immediately, once they are woken up and connected, will want to start balancing the cells, and they'll do that in between the packs as well. If your battery banks or your battery packs are woken up, you risk when you connect these interconnects, a fair bit of current will want to flow, and you can end up with a spark as you push these connections in. So you do not want to have your communication cables in and the battery packs woken up. But I'll show you how to put them back to sleep. For now, I'm going to wake them up. When I wake them up, you should see some LEDs flicking, and they'll all wake up just by the reset on the one. So there we go. I've pushed it. You see the first pack wake up. And now you see the lights flashing on the other packs. They then wake up and do a little blink. And what happens, it'll then go into a state and blink, and with these LEDs you can see the state of charge. You can also see error codes. So the one thing I'll highlight, there we go, I just want to highlight that on my multimeter now we can see 52.47 volts. So now we can see the terminals have woken up and they are live. In the manual, you can, if you don't have the software, the blinking lights can indicate a certain error state. There is a run state, there is an alarm mode. And depending on the type of blink, they'll notify there's a blink one. So there's a fast blink with a certain pause, a slower blink, and they label them blink one, blink two, blink three. You can see there's over voltage, over current. On page 8 of the manual, I've noted there's a misprint where they talk about a certain error. They note blink one, and I can't remember whether it's over voltage or over current. They then mention blink one again, and then blink three. That second blink one, I believe, should be a blink two, because the rest of the table is exactly the same, but for a different error code. So assume there's a typo there. So right, I've woken up the battery bank. If I want to put it to sleep, you just push the reset button and hold it in for a few seconds. And after a few seconds, the battery bank will switch off. And as you can see, the voltage is decreasing. So I assume there's some capacitance there, but you'll see the voltage actually slowly drops over time. But nonetheless, the terminals are now being switched off, but just be mindful of that. The voltage is still there for a little while. There may not be much energy behind it, but just be wary. It does take time for that voltage to slowly drop down back to basically zero. So now I'll show you the software. Right then, so before I bring you into the screen and show you the software, you will get a little dongle. So this is an RJ45 to USB. When you plug this in, it should load a device driver. I found that mine loaded. You can go check your COM ports. This will be set up as a COM port. and then you want to set the baud rate at 19,200. I'll show that there. But that then connects to your PC, and then you get one of your RJ45 cables, which will come with the packs, the battery packs from Seplos, and this is what goes into the RS485 port and allows you to communicate. Once you've installed the software, what you're going to see is you're going to see the Mandarin or Chinese, and it can be then confusing on what to do next. But up in this top left hand corner, you can see it says import protocol. You click on that and you import the configuration. So when you see it says import protocol, and I believe it is the actual protocol file. So under the Seplos battery monitor software, you'll see it's got a folder called agreement. I'm not sure why they call it agreement. I do believe it is literally just a protocol setup. But under here, you'll see they've got a version and it's got the number of cells. So the battery pack that I've got has got 16 cells. It says version 20. And it says EN for English. So once you click on that and click open, I think it comes up with an acknowledgement screen. That'll then ensure that your software has got the correct information to communicate correctly and then pulls in the English. Once you've got your dip switches set correctly, now again, so when I say correctly, I'm going to show you where I'm going to end up with an error because I've got this configured for CAN bus. But you've got two ways of communicating. For one, again, select your COM port and select the baud rate. Ensure that obviously when you load the driver, you've got the same baud rate set in the configuration. You've then got this connect option. You can then highlight what packs you've got. So you can either highlight and then do connect, or you've got where you can just address one pack directly. So you've got connection config. And if I go and deselect all the packs, I can go here and set, go over here and say, go to a certain pack. So I'm going to go to, I should be able to address pack 3, right? So even I have to stop and think because of the different addressing. I then click on setting and then click on connect. And Bob's your uncle, up pops the connection to pack 3. And you'll note it actually says pack 3 over here. At the moment I've got, oh, there we go. You can see an error. So the reason I've got that error light flashing is because I think it realizes that the addressing for RS485, there's an issue because I've not got the dip switches set up correctly for that. I've got it so it'll connect to an inverter. But I say, we're going to cross that bridge right now. But with this, you can see you've got, you can see your maximum voltage, minimum voltage. It shows you the voltage differential, which is 2 millivolt across all the cells. You can see all the individual cells. There's, you can use this to update the firmware. So if you break the connection over here, you then have an option to update the firmware on this pack. It brings up another sub application to do your firmware update. And you can see the state of health and any warnings. You can also, you can connect in here and also change certain parameters. So there's a password, I believe it's admin admin. So the username is admin, password is admin. It's in their manual. And if you did need to make any changes, just be mindful that if you mess up the configuration, that might not be a good thing. So only make changes if you're directed to do so or you know what you're doing. But this is the software. So I've got this error. Now what I want to show you is that if I try and direct, I'm going to break the connection. I'm not going to use this little single thing to address packs. The one thing I noted that on the previous software, this had a pack 0, because obviously you can address, if you've got one pack, you address it as 0. This doesn't have a 0 here, but you can use this manual target configuration to address pack 0. So just be mindful of that. If I now go and select all the packs, right, presuming that I've got them addressed as 1, 2, 3, 4, and go connect, what I want you to note, you can see I've got pack 1 and it's now stuck here. What it should do is cycle through them, but it is now stuck here trying to communicate presumably with pack 2. It might get to pack 3 in some cases, but this is where now that I need to change the address. There we go. It's managed to get to pack 3 because it obviously timed out trying to get to pack 2, and it should get, and that is where I've got the issue in the way that I've got them set up at the moment. So I'm going to change the dip switches and I'll tell you what I've done so that I can see them. Right, so even as I'm filming here, I'm discovering some things that I hadn't realized before. So if you want to address all of the packs at the same time on the software, by default, if you just click connect and have nothing selected, it will try look for pack zero. But you do need to basically drop the addressing for the master pack. So in my case, where I had dip switches 5 and 6 set to tell it that it's got 3 slaves, you have to switch those off because that addressing is specific to CAN bus. So you have to go out of the CAN bus mode, if you will, and go back to RS485. So then my top pack is actually 0. And then if I just click on connect, bang, you'll see it comes up, pack 0. Right? And let me see if I can address... If I then break that connection, so here's the little catch though, and if I go select 1, 2, 3, because that's how the other ones are connected, and I click on connect, it'll then cycle through 1, 2, 3, 1, 2, 3, but not to the top pack because I don't have a zero address option here. So what I do in that case, I'll go back, I break the connection, I've just flicked up the dip switch on my top pack to be addressed as number 4. And now if I go to number 4, 1, 2, 3, 4. So now they can all be addressed. But obviously that's kind of out of logical order. My top pack is 4, I then go to 1, 2, 3. So that does save you changing the dip switches on all packs, which they do in their video. I don't know that there's any issue with the way that I'm doing it here. You just have to be mindful and have an understanding of the addressing structure. Once you understand the addressing structure, that the dip switches are set up for binary, the first 4 are for the actual individual packs, the second 4 on the master tell it how many slaves it's got. When you understand that logic, you should be able to figure out how to get to all your packs. As I say, because the manual didn't make this clear, I struggled for a little while trying to get the addressing set up correctly. Right, I'm doing this dark so that you can't see it. Just a point to note that if you do want the reset button, which activates or deactivates the pack to work across all of them, you then do need to have the addressing set up correctly for, I say, either RS485 or CAN bus. So in this case, I've reverted to the setting so my top one is basically set up as 0 and it's the master. I've got 5 and 6 up to tell it it's got 3 slaves. And let's just make sure I can wake them all up. So I push, you can see the count up. And you'll see in the subsequent packs are then woken up. Once they've gone through their kind of boot up, they'll then just do the flash to show that they're kind of in a ready state or what have you. And then to power off, it does the countdown on the top one. And you'll see it did that for the other pack as well. Sometimes they'll be out of sync. They might be a slight delay and then they do their countdown and power off. But yeah, just ensure you've got the addressing right. Obviously, if for any reason you've got the addressing wrong and they don't all go off, I would then attempt to individually shut them down. But it would be better to get the addressing correct so that they're listening to the master or the top pack. Right then, so I hope that was helpful. I realize that in many ways, I think I've gone into detail, which a lot of people may find don't really think they need. But I think if you are having any problems or want a holistic understanding of how those dip switches work and what they do and how the addressing works, it makes far more sense, because then you can get around the quirk of having to change the addressing in terms of trying to get the software to see the packs. Again, just be mindful of the order in which to do the interconnects and then the communication cables going to the inverter before you start everything up, or as I said, knowing how to shut the whole pack down to avoid things being live that don't need to be if you're actually connecting things up. In a future video, I'll actually show you where I commission it and I get it hooked up to the inverter. And obviously there'll be configuration settings on the inverter. But anyway, thanks very much for watching this video and I'll catch you soon for the next one. Cheers.